All right. I'm so excited to be here with you guys today. My name is Carrie Rogers, and we are here at Camp Buckner videoing this for you. I wish I could be with y'all live, but this is the best we could do today. So thank you for having me. And I wanted to start off just by saying thank you for doing this study. When I wrote it, I guess it's been 4 years now. I honestly didn't know if anyone besides my husband and a few of my closest friends would read it. So the fact that y'all are reading this and doing this in your church is beyond me, so thank you. I know that right now y'all have just finished the last week of the Bible study, woohoo! And you have talked about forgiveness and love, which was super easy, I know. Those were easy chapters, right? But not really. Those days really just barely scratched the surface of the depths that we could go into on forgiveness and love, but I hope that y'all were able to dig in there and just find some practical application of ways that you guys could apply that study pertaining to forgiveness and love. But I know you guys are going to talk about that in your groups, so I'm going to leave that for y'all to talk in your groups. And today I just kind of wanted to focus a little bit on day 5 of the study, which was kind of like our big review or our big kind of overhaul on what the whole study is about. Because the reality is, we could talk about these virtues until we're blue in the face, but if we don't get the beginning part, if we don't get what it means to clothe ourselves with Jesus and put him on every day, then the rest of it, honestly, it means nothing. But first, we're gonna practice our verse, because y'all have been doing it, right? Don't you think that I can't see you behind that camera, and then I'm listening, because we're going to say it together, and don't you guys let me say this by myself, okay? So is everybody ready? You've been practicing. Hopefully you've had some accountability in your groups, and you're ready to do this. All right. Okay, so you ready? Okay. Colossians 3:12-14. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself in compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with one another and forgive whatever grievances you have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all of these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Okay, how'd y'all do? Did you do good? Okay, give yourselves a hand. Good job. I hope you guys know by now that I'm super passionate about memorizing the Word of God. I just think when we wallpaper our minds with His Word, and we exchange our thoughts for His, it has the ability to change everything. Today, I just want to focus on 3 simple points, kind of a brief overview of the things that you talked about mostly in weeks 1 and 2, but I'm gonna present them in a little bit of a different way, so it won't be the exact same. The first one, point number 1, is it is time for us to settle our identity issues. Because the reality is, most of us have some serious identity issues. I have a very sophisticated prop here that I'm going to use. When I hold up this piece of paper, again, you're talking back to me, I'm hearing from you. I want you guys to tell me what you see, okay? So I'm going to hold it up. Okay, what do you guys see? I'm hearing some people talking. What did you say? Okay, so do y'all see a black dot, right? Okay, hold on, let me turn it this way and see if it helps. Can anybody see anything else? Anything? Okay, so yes, this is just a white piece of paper with a black dot. But the principle I want you guys to get from this is whatever we focus on always gets bigger. The reality is that there is way more white space on this than there is a black dot. But we get so fixed on the black dot that it becomes all that we see, okay? So whatever you focus on always gets bigger. I probably have had more identity and insecurity issues than anyone else in this room. I have been so incredibly insecure for a good part of my life because I spent so much time focused on all the things that were wrong with me. On my weaknesses, on my failures, on my flaws, on my inadequacies, just everything across the board. I focused so much on everything that was bad that became all I could see, and I was horribly insecure. And because whatever we focus on always gets bigger, that affected my identity. It affected my security and knowing who I was. But as I began to turn my gaze to Jesus, as my focus changed and I began looking at him and him alone. He changed my everything when it came to my identity. And I realized that I needed to stop trying to find myself so much, and I needed to sink myself in the one in whom I am found, who is Jesus. Y'all, we don't need to find ourselves. Our goal is actually to lose ourselves in the one in whom we are found. Who we are in Christ is the most true thing about us. But we get so caught up and focused on the lies, and we pull out our measuring sticks and start comparing. And our identities become shattered because whatever we focus on always gets bigger. This verse in Colossians just touches briefly on our identity. It says we are chosen, we are holy, and we are dearly loved. That's just scratching the surface of who we are in Christ. Every one of you should have a handout that y'all were given. And on this is a chart, front and back. These are all of the verses in the Bible that talk about our identity in Christ. And if you are a writer or a highlighter in your Bible, I recommend one day that you just sit at your kitchen table with a certain color. Let it be your identity color. And I underline or highlight every single one of these verses. Y'all, this isn't a name it, claim it thing, okay? This is who we are. This is the truth of who we are. We are a child of God, a part of the true vine. We are chosen and appointed by Christ. We have been justified and redeemed and freed and slaves to righteousness and free forever from condemnation and sanctified and accepted. And I could go on and on. What if this became the thing that we focused on? Think about how your identity issues would just fall away if this was the stuff that we focused on. Because especially when it comes to our identities, whatever you focus on is always gonna get bigger. You focus on who you are in Christ, y'all. It is the most true thing about you. Okay, so that's the first one. We are gonna settle our identity issues once and for all. Number two is just, it's time to step in to our new wardrobe. And obviously that's what the bulk of this Bible study is about. But the reality is every day we have two choices. We can go out in our flesh or we can put on Jesus, okay? Every day and actually all throughout the day, these are the two choices that we have. When we go out in the flesh, we're going out spiritually naked. We talked about in the study that the flesh is any time we're living apart from Christ, any time we're trying to do it ourselves, any time we're trying to muster our own strength or rally up some patience. Y'all, we can't do this by ourselves. Self-sufficiency is the word that comes to mind when I think about the flesh. And here's the thing, most of us, I think, assume the flesh is really ugly. But some of you guys have some really good-looking flesh. And I don't mean physically, although probably some of you really do have good-looking flesh, but that's not what we're talking about. Some of your flesh has been well-churched. Some of you are rule followers. And some of you have been going to church for a long time. So you know the things to say, and you know the things to do. That was me. But the reality is, if you are doing it independently, if you are not depending on Christ, you're just still walking in the flesh, even though it looks good. So that's our one thing. We can go out in the flesh, or we can clothe ourselves with Jesus. Romans 13:14 says, clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what this is all about. One thing we have to remember is when we are choosing to clothe ourselves, that always involves a death. We have to die to ourselves if we want to live to Him. So that's when we put off the old self. We die to our flesh, and we connect ourselves with Him. One of my favorite words, and it was in your day one of week one, is the word abide. Jesus says, abide in me, and I will abide in you. Y'all, that word just means to remain, to continue to be present, to be held, to be kept. Pretty much like, let's do this thing together. That's what Jesus is saying. You're not out there by yourself. I want to do your life with you. And then we talked about in Matthew 11, 28 through 30, when Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. I think a lot of us like the come part. Come to me. We have all done really well to come. But I think that we're missing the abide part, a lot of us are. We're missing the come and let me do life with you. Come and stay. That was his intention all along. He wants us to come and stay. We are called to abide in him, to put him on, and to do our lives with him. And so then the verse talks about the different virtues. Compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, forgiveness, and love. And y'all, honestly, even just like running through the list, it wears me out. Because in and of ourselves, we can't do this stuff. In my flesh, I have got nothing. I have tried so many times and tried to muster it up so many times. Like, okay, I'm going to be super patient with my kids today. And by noon, it's gone. I've already totally blown up when I try to do it by myself. But John 15, let's go there actually, because I could just blow through this really fast. But I want you guys to turn with me. Let's go to John 15. Verse 4 and 5, and we'll read it together. I could just camp out in these verses. Okay, John 15, 4 and 5. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing. Getting that end part, that apart from me, you can do nothing. That was a hard truth for me to swallow because honestly, I felt like I could do a lot of good stuff for Jesus. But when the truth of it really sunk in, and let's be honest, when the truth of it finally hit me across the face, and I realized how utterly dependent I was on him. I can't do this stuff on my own. And honestly, I've changed the way that I pray now because I used to say, help me be patient. I want to be kind. Help me to be kind. Help me to be compassionate. And I don't ask for his help anymore because honestly, I don't want his help. I don't want him to help me. I want him to do it through me. I want him to do it for me. So it sounds silly. It's just a small little change in the way that I prayed, but it means everything because it means that I want him to be my patience. I don't want him to help me be patient. So now I say, Jesus, be my patience right now. Jesus, I need you to be forgiveness in me right now because I can't do this on my own. It's such a small little change in how I pray, but the posture has changed everything. Okay, so we have settle our identity issues, step into our new wardrobe, and the last one is just to shine. I just covered just one day on being a light, but it is like my very favorite picture of who Christ wants to be in me. It's just a light shining in this dark, dark world. I talked in the study just a little bit about the idea of being a solar lamp, and I wanted to give you guys the story of where that came from. There's this woman named Annabelle, and I was reading a devotion from her. And she spent a ton of time in her garden. She loved to garden. She toiled and spinned in the sand and planting. She loved spending time in her garden. And her kids, knowing how much she loved it, gave her some solar lamps one year for her birthday so that she could enjoy the beauty of her garden as much at night as she does during the day. And one day, Annabelle was sitting in her kitchen, looking out her window, and the day before had been super rainy, really overcast. There was very little sun. And when she looked out the window, she saw one of the solar lamps just like flickering. I was trying so hard to put out light. And she looked out and she just said, oh, little light, you can't shine on your own. You didn't spend enough time in the sun yesterday. And it's immediately, as soon as she said it, she realized the implications, because the same is true in us. We have no light to shine on our own. And so many of us want to shine for him, which is a fabulous thing. But if we haven't soaked in the sun, there is no light we can admit in and of ourselves. It's probably not a surprise that my favorite way of soaking in the sun is getting in the Word. And y'all, there are lots of ways through worship and prayer. I mean, there are a ton of ways that you can soak him in. But this is the one that I am most passionate about, because I have found life in these pages. I used to approach the Bible kind of like a Band-Aid. Like, I knew it was the place that I needed to go to when I had a hurt, when I had a disappointment or a discouragement or I had a need. I knew this was the place to go to. But what I have learned lately is that God didn't give us his word to make us feel better. He gave us his word to change our lives. He wants it to get inside us and do a work in us so that he can shine his light through us. So if there was anything that I could just beg of y'all, honestly, is to begin, if you don't have a desire for his word, just to ask for desire. It's a small prayer, Lord. I want to know your word. I want to know you in it. Give me a desire for your word. And don't pray it just once. Pray and pray and pray. And y'all, Jesus delights in honoring those type of prayers. He delights in a woman who lives and dwells in the truth of his word. So ask for it, will you? Okay, so that is it. It is time to settle our identity issues once and for all. We need to step out in our new wardrobe, and we were meant to shine. Let me pray for us as we close. Father God, I thank you so much, Lord, for these ladies in their willingness to sink themselves into this study. Father, we don't open your book or even this Bible study, Lord, just to learn more. We don't do it just to get more knowledge, Father. We want you to come into our hearts and our minds and our souls and change us from the inside out. Lord, we want an identity that is so rooted in you that it cannot be shaken. And Lord, practically, we want to learn what it means to put you on and do our day-to-day clothed in Jesus. Father, I thank you that you are in this, Father, and that you are moving, and that you are after the hearts of the ladies in this room. Father, we praise you for the work that you are doing, Father, and the work that is yet to be done. In Jesus' name, amen.